Good afternoon. Irma Bombeck went to church one Sunday, and she noticed that there was a mother and a son sitting at the service, but the son just couldn't stay still. And the mother kept quieting him. And then finally, Irma heard the mother say to the son, "Son, stop smiling. Don't you know we are in church?" This afternoon, I want everyone to smile. I want everyone to laugh. I want everyone to rejoice. This is one of the greatest moments in a pastor's life. Amen. And so we are rejoicing because we are going to witness the ordination service of Pastor Gavon Garcia. I knew I loved that brother. He's Latino. Garcia Marsh. And so I want to remind us that we're here to celebrate his calling, but we're here to celebrate above all God's anointing over his life and over his ministry. So keep that in mind as we celebrate, and I want to welcome all of us to this service. May God bless you.
Please stand with me as we sing number 100, "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Number 100. Here we go.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou gentlest
Let's bow our heads. Kind Father, we have come here this Sabbath afternoon for a special purpose. We have come to recognize your laying on of your spirit on a young man that has dedicated his life to your work. Oh Lord, we cannot do this without the blessing and presence of your Holy Spirit. So Lord, we now invite you to be here. Bless the proceedings. Be glorified in his life and in every life. Help us to wake up to the time in which we live. Give us a sense of mission and purpose. And Lord, prepare him and prepare us all for the great return that we so long for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Gathered together this afternoon to witness and participate in the ordination to the sacred gospel ministry of Pastor Gervon Garcia Marsh, who was born in Duncan's Trelawney in the country of Jamaica to Herman and Loretta Marsh. He grew up in a Seventh-day Adventist Christian home where principles of service for others, love for others, and dedication to God were highly esteemed. On account of these principles being an integral part of his life, Gervon was actively involved in church and community, serving in many leadership capacities. To name a few, he was youth choir director, Adventist youth leader, youth evangelist, and junior counselor within the Somerton community. It came as a little surprise when, after graduating from the Harrison Memorial High School, a Seventh-day Adventist institution there in Montego Bay, Jamaica, in the year 1998, he decided to enter the theology program at Northern Caribbean University to pursue his calling and also as his own recognition of God's call to the sacred ministry. In August 2003, Gervon graduated from the Northern Caribbean University with a Bachelor of Arts degree in religion and theology. He concentrated in pastoral ministry. Following his graduation, the North Jamaica Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, sensing his call by God to be a pastor, extended a call to him to join the pastoral ministry in that field in December of 2003. For 4 years, he honed his leadership and pastoral skills and fulfilled his God-given call, ministering to God's people in diverse areas and led hundreds of individuals to Christ through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. In 2007, he began working with the Florida Conference of Seventh-day Adventists here in the United States of America as a pastor of the Homestead Seventh-day Adventist Church. And subsequently, he ministered at the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church, Margate, and Palm Springs. I was listening for those amens as well. His integral involvement in evangelism and youth ministry has led many to have a saving relationship with Jesus over these many years of ministry. In May 2014, Gervon graduated from the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary at Andrews University with a Master's of Divinity. Presently, he has the joy of serving as the associate pastor, or as associate pastor of the Miami Temple Seventh-day Adventist Church I heard that. And his service here has been his passionate engagement since July 2014. Gervon is not married. That is to say, he is a pastor without having a wife. Fortunately, however, Gervon is engaged to Miss Peter Gay Yannick Stubbs. And together they expect to exchange marital vows on the 20th of December of this year, 2015. That is to say, exactly 3 months from today. It is my pleasure to present Gervon Garcia Marsh for ordination to the Sacred Gospel Ministry of the Global Seventh-day Adventist Church. May God continue to bless him.
Thank you. The passage of scripture that is selected for this afternoon is most appropriate for the occasion, and I invite you to engage with me by standing and repeating. This is a responsive reading, and as soon as I'm done reading, you will begin as together we engage in the scripture reading. If you can fish out this piece of paper from your program, you will probably find the scripture there. I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were the seraphs, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 wings they covered their feet, and with 2 wings they flew. And they were calling to one another, "At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me,
I am ruined,
for I am undone, and I live among the people of the universe, and I have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Amen. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongues from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Thank you for helping me out. Amen. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net in the lake, for they were fishermen. He said, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. Together, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end. May the Lord bless those who heard and those who participated in his word. You may be seated. Thanks.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. Buenas tardes, hermanos y hermanas. My very special joy and privilege to be here to share with you on this very special occasion this afternoon. Permit me to acknowledge the presence of Elder Mike Cawley, President of Florida Conference, and his wife, his spouse, Dottie Cawley, and also the other officers, other administrators who are here from the Florida Conference. Also other workers, Pastor Cortez, host Pastor Labraham, and others. My special joy to share God's word as a charge to Pastor Gervon Marsh this afternoon. I've entitled the charge, This One Thing. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Our gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, your Son, we come this afternoon, confident, knowing that your presence is here with us, knowing that you are in charge of this program. Now, Father, I present myself into your hands for you to take me, to use me, to let self be denied and Christ's name be magnified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A few weeks ago, the world stood transfixed as two of the world's most outstanding sprinters lined up near to each other in the finals of the 100 meters, men's 100 meters, at the World Championships in Beijing. After just 2 or 3 seconds into the race, it was evident that the race was going to be between these two outstanding sprinters. Then after just about 9 under 10 seconds, it was over. But the two men, as they rushed toward the line, as I looked at the replays and saw the two men rushing towards the finish line, both straining, stretching, reaching, focusing, just about 9.79 seconds after, they dashed across the line. And it seems to me that the one who was focusing better of the two won that race. It's a fit illustration, I think, of what Paul was attempting to say in Philippians 3, verse 13. Turn in your Bibles with me. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. As I reviewed this text in preparation for the message today, I came across something I just somehow did not observe before. The text in verse 13 literally says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing, forgetting those things." The words "this," from the term "this one thing," that word "this" and then the verb "I do," those are supplied words. So Paul was really saying, I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing. Not necessarily one thing I do, just one thing. One thing, forgetting, reaching, straining, I press toward the finish line. That's what those two athletes were doing. Forgetting, now there were a number of illustrations, explanations, excuses, clarifications that were made before that race. But when they came to that time, they forgot all things behind. The one focus now was the line ahead. One focus. I pressed toward the mark. One focus. One aim. When they dashed toward that line, I remember as I looked at the replays, I saw one athlete just glance, as it were, through the side of his face at the other. Moments, just moments before the finish line, and dipping at the line, the two men reached for the tape. This is a kind of spirit that God calls his people to have in these days. We are to have one great focus, one great objective. As a matter of fact, although Paul was speaking of obtaining salvation, here I want to apply it to Pastor Gervin Marsh this afternoon. And to his charge, to his commission, to his call, Pastor Marsh, God says there must now be one thing. So here should be the statement of Pastor Marsh this afternoon. I count not myself to have apprehended, to have reached, to have sufficiently matured. I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing. I have one objective. I have one goal. I must reach one mark. That one mark is demonstrated in the call, the great commission Christ gave to his disciples in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. In verse 19, he says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost." One commission, one call. This one thing, Pastor Marsh. Go, Jesus says, teach all, baptize in the name of Jesus. The Great Commission was given by Christ. And it was given at a time when the disciples were experiencing a great disappointment. They were hoping, looking, desiring that Christ would have been going to Jerusalem to seize the kingdom, to establish his throne, to usher in everlasting righteousness at that time, and to usher in this physical earthly kingdom. That's what they expected. But they were disappointed. Jesus went to the cross and laid down his life for sinners like all of us. The bitterness of their disappointment was expressed by the two men on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24, verse 13. As a matter of fact, the record says, "And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about threescore furlongs. The Bible tells us that one of them bemoaned in these words, "But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel." In other words, they were bitterly disappointed. They expected that Christ would have been the one to redeem Israel, but no, he had died. Bitter disappointment. But Christ had given the commission in the midst of the disappointment. "Go therefore and teach all nations." Thus it is in a similar context in Revelation chapter 10, in that wonderful chapter that outlines the history of God's prophetic movement. God gave a commission again to the Adventist church. Revelation 10 verse 11, "And he said unto me," the angel speaking to John, after John had eaten the book and it was sweet in his mouth but bitter in his belly, representing the bitterness of the disappointment in the 1844 movement. The angel said to John, "Thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings." This commission, Revelation 10, relates directly to God's great last day remnant church, the Adventist church in the last days, and to its ministers, to its leaders, to Pastor Gervin Marsh. The commission is, "Thou must prophesy again before many peoples, many nations, many tongues, many kings." In other words, we cannot rest. We cannot relax. A world is perishing in sin. Millions, no, not millions, billions are lost in sin, dying in sin. And God calls men and women today to throw out the lifeline, to preach this message, to let the world know that there's a truth for this time, a truth to lead souls, men and women, to the foot of the cross. In Revelation 12, verse 17, "Lest there be any mistake, lest there be any doubt, lest there be any concern," God specifically identified the people for the movement. And the dragon was wroth with the woman, God's church, went to make war with the remnant of her seed, God's last day people, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. God identifies the people. We are this peculiar people with a special message to all nations, all peoples, all tongues. That is why the Adventist minister has to be a man of God. That is why the Adventist minister must be a consecrated person. That is why the Adventist minister must have just one focus, this one thing: the message of God, the love of God to a dying world. I think Jesus sums it up in a lovely way when in Matthew 18, he shares that parable. Matthew 18 and Luke 15, he shares that parable of the good shepherd having 100 sheep and losing one. Imagine this parable with me. The shepherd has 100 sheep. In the evening, he calls the sheep to himself. Then he scans across the fold, and doubtless he counts 10, 20. He reaches 90, 95, 96, 97, 98. He counts 99. But he can't be sure. Now, this is a good shepherd. He wants to be very sure that all the sheep are present. This shepherd holds himself accountable for the sheep. So he counts again. 96, 97, 98, 99, not 100. Sure enough, one is missing. One sheep is lost. And he goes, the parable says in Matthew 18, Verse 12, how think ye, if a man have 100 sheep, and one of them be gone astray, doth he not leave the 99, and goeth into the mountains, and seeketh that which is gone astray? Consider the good shepherd, the pastor, one whom Pastor Marsh should know, emulate, the good shepherd. One sheep of the 99 is astray. It doesn't know its way back. It's lost. So in this parable, the shepherd could have done a financial analysis. To go for the one sheep would cost $100,000. It would be too expensive, far cheaper just to purchase another sheep and solve the problem. Is that what he does? No. One is lost, and he loves the sheep. He loves the one sheep that is lost. So he secures the 99. He doesn't leave the 99 to wolves. He secures the 99. Then he goes over hills, across valleys, climbing mountains, going through thorns. He bares his feet. Perhaps he gets hurt in the process. He's hungry, but he searches on. He knows that if he stops now, that sheep will be lost and will be gone. Perhaps the sheep is bleating. If he doesn't reach it early enough, the bleating will stop and he won't find it and it will perish. So he presses on. There's urgency. He drives forward. He goes and he continues to press and to press. One thing is in his mind. He has one focus: to find the lost sheep. So he puts aside every other consideration. He puts aside everything else. And he presses on for the one goal of reaching that one lost sheep. Then in the distance, he hears the bleating of the sheep. Sick, doubtless and helpless, ready to die, but it's still alive. He hears the sound. He catches the sound. He presses on. He finds the one lost sheep. And when he finds it, he could have done a number of things. He might have slapped the sheep and said, "You naughty sheep." Is that what he did? No. Happily, he embraces the sheep. He passes the sheep. He lays it on his shoulder. And he goes. He calls his friends. And he rejoices. This one sheep that was lost, I have found. This is the great mission of the Adventist minister: to reach every lost sheep for Jesus. This is, Pastor Marsh, your commission. This is the reason God's church is setting you aside for ministry. Not for personal gain. Paul was not looking at personal gain. He said, forgetting all those things which are behind. Worldly fame and popularity. He put those behind. Not these, but the one goal, the one objective of reaching souls for Jesus. This must be the mission of the Adventist pastor. And so, Pastor Marsh, I charge you in closing today. Let this be your one focus, Pastor Marsh: the salvation of souls for Jesus. Every nation, there's a territory here. There is a city. There is a country. There is a world. Billions are lost in sin. And God is calling for men and women, ministers, men of God, women of God, to stand up and focus on this one thing: the great objective of reaching even one lost sheep for Jesus. Across the world, many people are doing this. But the Adventist minister, Pastor Marsh, is a unique minister. He has a unique message, a remnant message for our people in the last days. So may God be gracious to you, Pastor Marsh. May he fill you with his Holy Spirit. May he pour out his blessings upon you and grant you that you will focus on that one thing, the salvation of souls. And when Jesus comes again and all of God's people are assembled around the great white throne, you can be there and all of God's people can be there as well. May it be our experience to share in that joy when Jesus comes again.
The church, your church, has recognized God's calling in your life. Through the fruit of your ministry, the church now, who has seen God's hand at work in your life, is going to ordain you and recognize that calling. So this prayer, this ordination, this prayer of dedication, is an act of faithfulness to what God is already doing. And so we're going to gather now together. I think we're going to gather on the floor level. There's a little space here. And I'd like to invite any of the ordained ministers that happen to be with us to join us in this circle down here around Pastor Marsh. So let's go down there and we're going to pray together for you. I'd like to ask the congregation if you'd like to kneel with us as we pray. Lord, we are indeed humbled to be before you today. It requires a special sense of humility to come in this service because none are worthy. None have earned or deserve your calling. Our being here is because you somehow, who knew us from the beginning, chose to place a calling on this man's heart. You knew him before he had any awareness of your purpose. You knew him while he was still blind to your love. And even then, you called him because in him you saw one willing who would give himself to your service. So in that humility, we acknowledge, first of all, your calling in our lives. Lord, you have called all of us in this room to love you, to serve you. Some of us you have called to be pastors and teachers, shepherds. And in acknowledgement of that calling, we come today to ask for your blessing. We know that we are your people. And in being your people, we turn to you because only you can do what we call upon you to do today. As we praise you today for what you've given us Jesus, who proclaimed the very meaning of ministry. He demonstrated the meaning of ministry in his life, in how he gave himself to others. He taught us all what it means to be a servant to all. He called us to reach out to those who are separated from your love, who are far from you. And we thank you, Lord, for giving Gavon a deep desire to serve you in reaching those hearts. Here today, we are your hands as we seek to bring your blessing on Pastor Gavon Marsh, who has heard your call to ministry and who has dedicated himself to your service. Give him the aid and counsel of your Spirit that he may serve you with all authentic faith and a consistent life, that he may preach your word and power with power and grace, that he may be your healing voice to a suffering world, that he may build your kingdom and bring honor and glory to your name, and in all things he may be your good and faithful servant. And so now, Lord, as we place our hands upon Gervon in humility, in the name of Jesus, we pray for the anointing of your Holy Spirit. Without the baptism of the Spirit, our words and our acts are powerless. And so we ask that in this sacred moment of dedication, of ordination to the high calling of gospel ministry, that this pastor be bound in love and commitment to you, as only you and by your Spirit can work in his heart and hold him near to you. And Lord, we ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Well, Elder Marsh, what a privilege it is today to recognize you formally as a minister of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in full standing and set aside by a prayer of consecration, ordination. And it is a privilege for us to see how God has led your life, how he continues to grow and mature you and develop your leadership and bless you in such powerful ways. And so it's our privilege today, on behalf of the worldwide Seventh-day Adventist Church, to welcome you to the ordained ministry. You are now able and commissioned and sent forth by the hand of God to go and baptize and organize churches and preach in Jesus' name, ordain elders and deacons like the Apostle Paul did in the book of Acts, as an ordained minister recognized around the world within your Seventh-day Adventist faith community. So I'd just like to read a passage of scripture here for a moment. And we are very proud of you, and there are many people within this congregation today who love you and have indicated that. This is a beautiful testimony to you, how much people have been blessed by you. So from the words of Paul to Timothy, another pastor, he says, God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began, but has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, to which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles. For I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he who is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. May God bless you, and may the Spirit of Jesus rest upon your life as you prepare for greater things that the Lord will do through you for the honor and glory of Jesus Christ.
Elder Marsh, it's my privilege to be able to welcome you to the ordained ministry, though you've been pastoring for a while now. And I'm sure you already do this, but I just want to encourage you to keep spending time with God every day. That is the most important thing I believe any of us can do. And then secondly, I congratulate you on your upcoming wedding. And I just want to really encourage you to spend time with your family. That is so important. God's work is important. I believe that God comes first, then family, then the church. And the church sometimes can make you so busy doing busy stuff that's really maybe not that important, when the important thing is to spend time with your family. And I have pastors tell me, oh, I have so much to do, I just don't have time to take a day off with my family. Well, they're going to suffer the consequences, I'm afraid, because I believe God has ordained each of us to spend time with our families. So I want to encourage you with that and just want to congratulate you again. God bless.
Well, Elder Archer gave us a great charge for your ministry. One thing, I love that. I want to give you another charge. This one is on a plaque here. Because, you know, you've enjoyed and experienced a lot of ministry already. Going from this day, you realize you've just begun a journey that will continue for many years to come. And there will be challenges along the way. So it's important to remind yourself from time to time what really is the one thing, what's really most important. And this charge is designed to give you something to look back upon, remind you what ministry really is about. And it's partly based upon the words of Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, as he spoke to those early disciples who were going to be his missionaries, and he was letting them know what was most important and helping them to be reminded of that. So let me share with everyone what's on this plaque. Only God can place a call in the heart of his servant. On this day, the church has affirmed your call and has set you aside by the laying on of hands. Now you are charged to go from this service as one who is sent from God to serve his church in fulfillment of his mission. Let the words of Jesus be your commission. Choose often to sit with the disciples as Jesus teaches them to be his disciples and to make disciples for him. You are the salt that reveals the flavor of Christ's redemptive work. You are God's light to a darkened world. You are perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect when you mirror his perfect love for all people. You are a bearer of God's gift of grace. Follow Jesus as he teaches you to pray. Receive the forgiveness of God and then always be willing and ready to forgive. Trust in heavenly things and not the things of this life. Strive for the kingdom of God, and all your true needs will be provided. Ask and it will be given. Search and you will find. Hear and act on the words of Jesus, and you will be like the man who built his house on a rock. Let these words that Jesus spoke to those first Christian missionaries be your charge as you are sent to be his missionary leader. Pattern your ministry after Jesus, for you are asked to serve as his hands, his feet, and his voice. Like him, you are called to be a servant to others. Like him, you are to be a teacher, proclaiming God's love. Follow Jesus, be his disciple, and teach others to do the same. Now, as you go and follow his call, go and make disciples. Go and baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and teach the observance of all things, and remember Jesus' promise, I am with you always. And you will need that last part. God is always by your side, so never forget. God bless you. Come on.
Pastor Gervin Garcia March. I didn't know you had Garcia in you. At this time, it's my happy privilege to present you the ministerial credential and the certificate of ordination. And they give evidence that on the day of the Lord, September 19, 2015, in recognition of your years of dedicated service to the Lord, the Florida Conference Administration has set you apart for the gospel ministry through an ordination ceremony here at Miami Temple of Seventh-day Adventist. And as an ordained minister, Pastor Colley just mentioned, you are now fully authorized to perform all the functions of the ministerial office by the order of Florida Conference. Congratulations on the accomplishment of another milestone in your ministerial journey. And it is my prayer that God bless you as you work in his vineyard. God bless you.
I'm not sure why I'm opening this program. There's nothing in there to be read, but. So Tim did warn us to write something and bring your kerchief, your hanky, because you may just shed a tear. I promise you I will not cry. At least I'll try not to. That's right. And that word is exactly what I have on my mind as I sat there and as I've been thinking about this moment. There's one thing I can say, one thing. I'm glad to be a part of the family of God. I'm glad to be a part of the family of God. And as I think of that, I think of my family in a number of ways. I think of my family in terms of my church family back home in Jamaica. Here today is Elder Evelyn Ranger from the Brownstone Seventh-day Adventist Church and possibly others who have journeyed to share in this moment. And I thank you. Elder Ranger, where are you? Could you just read? There you are. Good to see you. One of my spiritual mothers in the faith. So glad to see you and others who have decided to be here. But then when I left Jamaica and moved here, God blessed me with another family. I left Jamaica and came back in 2007. Didn't have a job, and then one, and I actually had intentions of moving to Andrews University when one of my ministerial colleagues said to me, no, we want you to go volunteer at a church. Now, I don't know if you know anything about a pastor's salary, but it's almost volunteer already, you know? So, yeah. So. When he said to me, go volunteer, that took on a whole different meaning for me. But while volunteering at the Homestead Seventh-day Adventist Church, I found another family. Will the Homestead brethren here just raise your hand? All the Homestead brethren, they became my family. They supported me. I had no means of income, but they gave the pastor a nice little stipend. And the conference gave, you know, a travel allowance, and they found me a nice place to put up, and they put up with me for a year as we worked together to build up that church, and God blessed our ministry there. But then God moved me from there and gave me another family. He gave me a family for 3 years in the ministry and work of the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church. And you see and hear them cheering on because God did wonderful things through us there. And all of them have become family. And by the way, God is so good. Almost every church I go, I end up being adopted by some sweet lady. So I have adopted mothers at Homestead. I have adopted mothers in Brownstown and other churches in Jamaica. I have a number of adopted mothers in Maranatha. And I won't start calling names, lest I get myself in trouble, but thank you, Maranatha, for the way you have contributed to my growth and my development in ministry. But then God decided to move me from there. And just for 8 months, I had the joy and privilege of serving at the Margate and Palm Springs Seventh-day Adventist churches. And they are here this evening. And I thank you so much for blessing my life as I sought to bless your life. I thank you. But you know, as I think about family, I can't help but think about my immediate family. You know, I grew up in a home where you know, everything surrounded God. And when I was born, my dad, before I was born, my father was a deacon in the Baptist church. And somehow my mom was able to get him out of there and join the Adventist church. And so by the time I was born, he had been an elder in the church for way over 20 years. Still is an elder in the church. My dad is not as strong as he once was. You hear my voice, I got it from him. The only thing I didn't get from him was the height. He's not as tall as he used to be simply because of his illness. But my dad is here today. And I've ministered to many of you, and you have often asked, you know, where's your dad? What about your dad? Well, my dad, I really wanted to live here, so my mom has been the one who's been back and forth. And now she's retired, you know, she's here sometimes and she's there most of the time. And thank you. And we tease each other sometimes because when my mom's around, I promise you, every morning I get a beautiful breakfast. Last Sunday morning I went cycling, we did almost 40 miles, and when I got home, I had, for those of you from Jamaica, you'll understand, I had fried breadfruit, ackee, fried dumplings, and some other, and I'm like, so I would call my dad sometimes and tease him, did you have breakfast yet? Because I just had breakfast, you know? And then sometimes he would call and tease me, but I thank God for him, because in our community, many think that he's a pastor. He's not a pastor, he's been an elder, but many people think he's a pastor. But his influence has been very significant in my life. Each morning as he would pray with us and pray for us, and every day he still does that. And then my mom, you know, I've reached points in ministry already where I've decided to just throw in the towel and forget ministry. I remember once, when that happened, and I went to my mom, and I shared with her the things that were going on. And I said to her, Mommy, I'm tired of this. I'm not doing this no more. And I thank God for her. You know, I'm not a judgmental woman. With all that I shared with her, she simply looked at me and asked me, Gervon, how many weeks vacation do you have? And then she said, you know what? Just take some time off. Go to Jamaica, relax, pray. And then she prayed with me. And thank you, Mommy. Yes, thank you. My brother-in-law, Carl, he's the president of North Jamaica, but he's my brother-in-law. My sister, Lisa, his wife, Valina, Sandra, Alita, who are here, Mike, my brother-in-law, Mark. Where's Sandra? Sandra and Eric. And then I see my cousins, Chris, Claudette, Ms. Monroe, good to see you. And then my other family at Royal Palm, thank you. And then, it wouldn't be appropriate to not do this. As was said, I will be finally getting married. Bless God. So I thank God in advance for my family to be. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here today, but she's been watching on FaceTime. And so, Papa Sickle, I just want to let you know that I love you. And I thank you for your support. And I know that God will continue to bless our ministry. And then, you know, God has blessed me with two brothers who are not here, unfortunately, but he's blessed me with a brother in the person of Carlisle. And Carlisle, thank you, man. Thank you for being there for me. Thank you for being my boy. Thank you for supporting me. Thank you for praying with me. Thank you. I just want to thank, especially now, the family that has adopted me here at the Miami Temple Seventh-day Adventist Church. You're my joy. You're my strength. Feet. You're my boy. Thank you. Morris, love you. Appreciate you. For all my friends that are here, I thank you, I thank you, I thank you. Thank the administration for their investment in me and for their appreciation of the work that God has been doing through me. And I just want to thank you all, and I thank God for this wonderful family that He has given me in all of you.
We are Miami Temple, and we, the members of Miami Temple, welcome you, Elder Marsh, to the fellowship of the called and the ordained. We feel privileged that this public recognition of your ministry occurred in our church. I had some of the best historians of this church do some digging to find out when was the last time we had an ordination in our church. In 105 years, we've not been able to find someone. So we are kind of accepting the fact that your name will go down to the annals of the history of Miami Temple. As a luminary, you have clearly displayed your gift of evangelism in our midst through your fiery sermons filled with evangelistic fervor. You have wowed us with your mastery at memorizing scripture and reciting them with the eloquence and intellectual prowess of the Greek orator Demosthenes. You have engaged us with your infectious laughter and your passion for God. You have been called and you have accepted that call. Today, we celebrate with you the public acknowledgement and recognition of this call. You came to us, you've blessed us, and guess what? You are family. We are Miami Temple. We are diverse in many, many ways, yet we remain one under the banner of Christ. It is under His banner that we accept you as one of our ministers. We promise to encourage you and support you in Christian love. We will do our best to catch you when you're doing something right. And when we disagree with you, we'll pray with you and for you. We agree to minister with you and not let you carry the burden alone. We'll give you our time, our talents, and we'll give our money to pursue the work of God in this church, in this neighborhood, and throughout the worldwide Seventh-day Adventist Church. We will welcome with open arms your other half now that we finally have a date for the wedding. We are all expecting an invitation. We love you way too much to see you alone any longer. If one day you are called to another pasture, just know that you're leaving the greener pasture behind. We are Miami Temple, and so are you. Welcome, brother.
Here in the water with me is Shari Rose. I've been studying with her for a number of weeks now, and it's as a direct result of her mom coming to me and saying, "Pastor, I want you to prepare my daughter for baptism." Now, the interesting thing is, through all the studies we've done, my work has basically been made redundant because her parents have done a good job of preparing her for baptism. And so I'm going to invite her mother, her dad, her little brother, AJ, and all the friends and family from the children's department, all her friends, to come on up, come on up. If it's even at the front here, come and join us. And the reason why I'm doing this today is this. Today is Sherry's actual birthday. And she said, I want to get baptized on my birthday. So not only is it the day of her biological birth, but it's the day of her new birth in Jesus Christ. And so we thank God for Sherry, and we thank God for her parents, for her friends. And this is how we do it at Miami Temple. We all gather around and celebrate with her. And there's your brother, and there's mommy, and there's daddy. And there are your friends, and they're happy to have you here. And so, Sherry, it's been a joy studying with you, and we'll continue our studies even after you've been baptized. And I am very impressed with how much you know of the Bible and how much you have displayed that you love the Lord. And so it's my joy as an ordained minister to baptize you as the first person baptized as an ordained minister. And so, Sherry, because of your love for Jesus, and because you've given your life to him as an ordained minister of the gospel, I pray God's blessing on your life, and I baptize you now in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the blessed Holy Spirit. Let God's people say. Let's continue to pray for Sherry, for her family, and let's support her here at church as she grows together in Jesus Christ. God bless you.
Our closing hymn is number 633. Just a reminder, we have a fellowship hall on my left, your right, that door, and we have some refreshments, and that way you can congratulate our wonderful Elder Marsh on this beautiful day. Please rise with me. Let's sing number 633 for our closing song.
Sing thou wondrous let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the cause of life be paid. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty.
what a day it will be. We long for it from the bottom of our heart. Today, we have celebrated. To be part of your great family is a blessing beyond anything else that we could ask or hope. Yes, today we've done some things. We've divided the word, we have sung. We have commissioned, we have given credentials. But all of that is just a human act, visible to others, of what you have already done for Gervon. Rest your spirit upon him, upon his bride-to-be, and Lord, upon this church and others he will serve, that we may hasten the day together when you do return, in Jesus' name. Amen.